Hi everybody, Joey here again and welcome back. So in today's video, I want to show you how to build an aquarium overflow. However, specifically, I want to focus on showing you how to build one of the cheapest and easiest types of weirs that you can for an aquarium overflow. Now this video was actually inspired by last week's video. You see, last week's video wasn't supposed to be this filter. In fact, this filter was supposed to be the weir. Yeah, once I got into building it, I thought, why don't I show them how to build the filter first, and then show them how to convert it into a weir. The first thing we're going to need to do is remove the filter. Luckily, it's really simple to do, which is great in case you ever change your mind on this filter. All you need to do is take a straight razor and run it along the silicone seams that you created originally. Once the filter is removed, you can remove any additional silicone with your razor blade. Now the tank's ready to move forward with building an overflow and weir into this aquarium. Now if you're lost and don't remember what we did here, basically we cut a bucket into a few sections and created a filter out of it using a piece of the bucket to act as a barrier for the sponge filter that we made behind it. If you didn't see that video, I highly suggest watching it because it's a great method of filtration. Now because we only used a small portion of the bucket, that means we have plenty left of it to do other things with, including build this weir. Before we move any further though, let's talk about why we would have an overflow on our aquariums in the first place. To keep it simple, you've probably seen people drilling their aquariums before or having sump filtration under their aquariums. Essentially, a sump goes under your aquarium and you need a way to get water from your main aquarium down to the sump and then back up again. Having an overflow installed in your aquarium allows you to have sump filtration. The first thing we need to do is actually drill the aquarium and install a bulkhead, but before we do that, we have to decide on the plumbing. Though there's multiple ways that you can plumb an aquarium, including how you want to have your standpipes, but for the purpose of this video, I'm keeping things really simple just to give you a basic explanation on how things work, with a focus on showing you how to build and install a weir. So just like the filter video, we take a bucket and decide how much of the bucket we're going to use. And in this case, I've got a wedge that will fit where I want it to be. Now obviously this tank is far too small to install an overflow on, but I'm just using it for an example. To know how much of the bucket you actually need though, you should test putting your bulkheads and whatever else plumbing you want behind it and see if it's all going to fit. Once you know how big this needs to be, my preference is to turn the tank upside down and then mark off where I need to drill for the bulkhead. Now I actually have videos on do-it-yourself aquarium bulkheads, so if you prefer to build them instead of purchasing, feel free to do so. I'm going to leave a few links in the description below that will help you with a lot of the things we're talking about. Then simply drill the aquarium. Now I also have a video on how to properly drill your aquarium, and again I'll leave that in the description below. A couple of things you want to kind of watch for when sizing your weir for your aquarium is not only to make sure that all of your plumbing fits inside, but you also don't want it too big or too small. You definitely want to be able to fit all your plumbing in there, but you should also make sure that you can reach your arm in behind it as well in case you ever need to. After you're done drilling your tank, you can install your bulkheads. Now at this point, you might be asking yourself, well, can't we just go from here and fill the tank up and use the bulkheads to deliver water down below? The answer is no. Imagine filling your bathtub up without the drain plugged. You literally would not be able to fill it up, you'd just constantly be draining the tub. That would be the case here, except the water that you're putting in is going to come out through the bottom, go to your sump, and then flood your house eventually. Now a standpipe is technically just PVC pipe. However, they come in a variety of different designs, meaning that depending on how you decide to configure the elbows on top of the standpipe will depict how quiet it is and how it works, for example. We're not going to get into that today. We're going to stick to the basics with the explanation. Now, if a standpipe is installed into the bulkhead, only the water that's pumped into the tank will drain out, and when the power goes out, water level will drop to be equal with the standpipe and can no longer flow down the standpipe. And now technically that's all you need. And yet you're probably wondering one very simple thing. Won't my fish get sucked down this? The answer is yes, they will. So you could design a strainer or something else to go on top of the standpipe to prevent that from happening. However, the weir is actually going to prevent that as well, and that's one of the benefits of having a weir. Another big benefit is it actually hides all of the pipe. Having a solid weir that blends into the rest of your background looks a lot better than having exposed pipe. Another huge benefit is that when power goes out or you turn off your pump for maintenance, if you just have a standpipe, however much water is above the standpipe is how much water is going to drain down to the sump. So for example, if you have about an inch of water or a half inch of water above the standpipe that's constantly draining in, which is very common, that means a half inch or an inch of the entire aquarium is going to drain down that pipe when the power goes out. With a weir installed, only a half inch or that inch of water that's above the standpipe is going to drain down that's actually behind the weir. So a ton of less water is actually drained down to your sump, which means that you can have a smaller sump or even have a bigger sump with more water in it without having to worry about needing it to be 20 gallons of extra space in there to drain down extra water. And those tend to be the three main benefits of having a weir. One, it prevents fish from getting sucked in. Two, it hides all of your plumbing. And then finally, three, it allows for far less water to drain down to your sump during a power outage or when you turn your pump off. So how are we going to build this weir? Well, if you watched last week's video, you know we took a bucket, cut the bottom off, and then cut out all of these wedges from it. We then trimmed off all of the lip that's on it, followed by drilling tons of holes in it for the filter, and then we sanded it, painted it, and then siliconed it in place. We're going to do everything we've seen in that video up until the point where we drilled it. We're not actually going to drill this one. So the first thing we need to do to take this bucket wedge and actually turn it into a weir is create the teeth for the water to overflow through, but the fish cannot. Now you'll notice that this wedge is really flimsy and really flexible, which is a good thing. What we're going to do is take a ruler or a straight edge of some sort and put it about 1 inch from the top of the bucket. Now, as another piece of advice, you should probably use a ruler or a straight edge or even a level that has measurements on it. That way it will make it easier for you to measure out and space your teeth more evenly. Then take a straight edge or a razor blade of some sort and start cutting out where you want your teeth to be. Now, the size of the teeth and how many you need will depend on a couple of factors. The first is how much your flow rate's going to be. The second is the size of your fish. The width is going to depend on the type of fish you're going to have. You want to make sure that the teeth are actually thinner than the width of your fish. Otherwise, you can add some sponge behind the weir to stop fish from getting sucked in. The height of the teeth depend on where you want your water level to be in your aquarium. The deeper the teeth into the bucket, the lower your water level will be. My suggestion is to make them about an inch or an inch and a half deep. To give you an example of how much flow you can get out of these, for every 1 inch deep by half inch wide, you can get 50 gallons per hour through it. My suggestion is to calculate how many teeth you need and what size they need to be, and then double the quantity. This way you never have a clogging issue. Now, when you're cutting the teeth out, the only real thing you need to worry about is that they are actually all level across, meaning that the water will overflow into the back of the weir evenly. If you do need to make some adjustments, as you had seen earlier, the bucket is really easy to cut anyways. Now the next step, just like the filter, is to paint it if you want to, unless you prefer the color of the bucket. Again, to paint it, we'll go with Krylon Fusion for plastic, and we'll allow it to cure properly. Once the paint cures, you can go ahead and install it into your aquarium. With the weir painted and now cured, we can go ahead and install it into the aquarium using silicone, just like we did in the filter last week. Give that silicone 24 hours to cure, and your weir is now ready to go. Now, when it comes to the standpipe or whatever type of plumbing you have behind it, you want to make sure that it's about 1 inch or 2 inches below the bottom of the teeth. This ensures that the water has to not only flow behind the weir, but drop down slightly, allowing you to get some skimming action of the surface of your water, which will remove any collected oil or proteins that are collecting at the surface, which in turn will aid in greater oxygen exchange. Now when we fill this up with water and plug a pump in, the water will start to overflow into the weir and fill the weir up until it reaches the standpipe, at which point the water will overflow down the standpipe and into your sump. Your pump will continuously pump water into your aquarium, and that cycle will continue to happen. Now, when the power goes out, water immediately stops pumping into the main aquarium. The water almost immediately stops draining down to the sump as well. Yet behind the weir stays full of water. So hopefully you have a better understanding as to how overflows work and the importance of having a weir. If you ever change your mind and you no longer want to have an overflow or a drilled aquarium with a sump, you can simply remove the weir like I showed you previously with the razor blade, remove the bulkhead, and simply patch the bottom with a piece of glass and silicone the same thickness as the bottom panel. Then simply put your substrate down and it will be like the tank was never drilled or there was never no overflow in place. So don't worry, it's not permanent if you don't want it to be. However, if you want to take a lot of your do-it-yourself skills and knowledge to the next level, you can do so with my book, The Ultimate Do-It-Yourself Handbook, or The Do-It-Yourself Aquarist. The book is far more educational and far more detailed than any one of my videos. If you want to get your copy, you can go to thekingofdiy.com, where I offer the ebook version as well as the soft cover signed by myself. Anyways, I hope that you guys enjoyed today's video. I also wanted to thank you for watching, and if you join me next Sunday, I'll have a new do-it-yourself project for you.